Hello. He's an archaeologist and specializing in prehistoric archaeology in northern Greece. For the last 3 years, she has been working as a researcher in projects of oral history and cultural heritage. And I think this is also the theme of the subject of your presentation. So, recreating tourism on the Greek Albanian borders through oral history and tradition. So, Angeliki, the screen is yours.
Good evening. Okay. Okay. Firstly, I would like to thank you for giving us the opportunity to present our work here today. And congratulations for your conference. It's really interesting and really fruitful for me, especially those 2 days were really fruitful. Okay. The cross-border mountainous area in Southeast Europe, Permet, Gjirokastra and Konitsa, is characterized by unique historical heritage. We can discover different sides of history and traditions, identify and promote common historical events, cultural and natural characteristics that under specific circumstances could function as promising tools for local sustainable development. During the 20th century, a variety of social and economic factors resulted in the depopulation and the abandonment of a wide variety of villages in northwestern Greece. Being in remoteness and isolation for so long, the time stopped. New needs and habits disturbed the social life and cohesion, but tangible and intangible cultural heritage has been well preserved. The abandonment transformed them into cultural reservoirs. Furthermore, the surrounding mountains, and we are close to Vikosaos Geopark, protected by UNESCO, a refugee for dense forests, drinking water, biodiversity, and raw materials. To this end, cultural preservation and natural characteristics form an opportunity for local sustainable development under cultural tourism. Today, Permet, Gjirokastra, Ioannina, and Konitsa are modern towns with many traditional markets, hotels, tavernas, shops selling local products and crafts. In the last decades, the cross-border area experienced tourism development. Many travelers are attracted, mountaineers, hikers, climbers, lovers of water sports, and many other people who visit the area to rest, to be in a clean and natural environment, serenity, remoteness. Commonly, these type of visitors are motivated by an urge to experience new cultures, to meet traditions, customs, authenticity. It is widely accepted that heritage interpretation and cultural tourism could play an important role in the economic development of the cross-border area, considering that activities under the umbrella of cultural tourism can promote tangible and intangible cultural and natural characteristics. But why and how cultural tourism and heritage interpretation are suitable in our case? Cultural tourism is developed through heritage interpretation enriches our lives through engaging emotions, enhancing experience, and deepening our understanding of people, places, events, and objects from the past. Cultural tourism encloses traditional and social customs, local history, art, and cultural events. Effective interpretation will involve a paradigm shift that rewrites the worldview script by interpreting old habits and meanings, mix them with new ideas to move society towards sustainability. Effective interpretation of natural and cultural characteristics of the cross-border area that are remote and still unknown could be a tool for the local economic and social development. A concept that should never be underestimated when we are dealing with heritage interpretation is the interaction with and within the local community. We need to recognize that the past is contested and our work is going to be intervention into an existing social context and our interpretations and beliefs. The interface between past and present is nothing more than people's memories. No memory comes to us without a context or a specific significance, and the boundary between private and collective memory is permeable. Public memories, as Anderson suggested, are imagined quite differently by every nation, group, or individuals, and are embodied in the landscape in tangible and intangible cultural characteristics. Public memories enclose meanings of what's happening in the world at a specific moment. In other words, they are a collection of facts, sights, and feelings. How memories of local people can be translated into the practice of cultural heritage. How it is possible to connect the common past cultural characteristics with a very different present. How the local communities could be involved. And finally, how could tourism development become sustainable in both areas? The four named questions are the reason for the existence of the Exploral and VirtuaLand projects. These projects built on the successful project Bakaneana, funded under the IPA cross-border program Greece-Albania 2007-2013, that delivered a multimodal digital library with contact from the Central Library of Konitsa and the Municipal Library of Gjirokastra. Firstly, the idea of this project was to transform the Public Library of Konitsa into a reference point for all tourists visiting the cross-border area and identify and promote the cultural and natural heritage of the cross-border region. The methods which were chosen were the study and analysis of oral history and tradition of the locals and their interconnection to a web mobile application and virtual reality interactive platform. Two different teams worked to complete those projects. A group of anthropologists, archaeologists that identified the places of special interest, studied the local literature and conducted interviews, and a group of programmers that actualized the web mobile application and the VR interactive platform. We focused on study on the regions of Gjirokastra and Konitsa. Firstly, a thorough review of local literature was conducted. According to this, the places of interest were detected. The research area were two, Konitsa from the Greek side and the surrounding villages named Mastorhoria, the villages of the craftsmen, and the region around Gjirokastra in Albania, in southern Albania, named the Ropoli, and here in this region still exists a Greek minority. So it is still present, the Greek minority. Our team visited those places of interest and conducted interviews with the locals in both areas in Greek. Our main goal was to collect myths, legends, fairy tales, traditional songs, and life histories attached to natural and cultural places. For example, a legend about a forest, a gorge, a church, or a castle. During this field research, 46 interviews were collected from both areas. We collected oral testimonies regarding Second World War, Greek Civil War, legends about haunted churches, ruined villages, songs about local heroes. The next step was the transcription of the interviews, followed by their categorization according to the topics I mentioned previously, and of course, according to the places of reference. The recorded testimonies, which were related to the digital context that is already stored in the archive of Library of Konitsa, were identified. As we have already mentioned, in the frame of the Explorer project, an application for mobile devices was developed. This includes interactive information on a map of the wider border area. The interactive map is interconnected with the context from oral sources and the digitized material of Balkaneana in the form of a customized documentary. Finally, the latest project, VirtuaLand, delivers a virtual reality interactive platform where selected archives are converted to cultural and touristic scenarios. The archives will be mainly acquired from the repositories Olympias and Epirus Mnemon of the University of Ioannina Library Library of Konitsa, and the University of Ioannina Folklore Museum. The museum contains extensive collection of traditional objects and archive of research articles and photographic material. Can we play the video, please, that I've sent? Okay. Here you can see the virtual reality platform. You will see the old market of Ioannina. And it's in Greek. The guide that narrates in Greek, so we don't have to see the whole video, just a minute. And the guide gives information about all the professions, craftsmen, and yes. Okay, thank you. I think it's do I have to share my screen again? Yes. VirtuaLand also delivers a library of 3D objects and an open VR platform when libraries, professionals in the tourism industry, or individuals with limited programming skills will be able to create their own VR stories, increasing the sustainability of the platform. Thus, training activities are foreseen in the use and extension of the VirtuaLand platform, but also on the cultural framework of the area. Our preliminary result. Specific places are now connected to traditional songs, legends, and oral testimonies of the local people. Abandoned villages regain their voices. Additionally, common cultural and historical events along the cross-border area were detected, together with differences regarding beliefs around the perception of life, religion, etc. Now I'll talk about a certain village, Derveni. Derveni is a village located exactly on the border of Greece and Albania. Derveni was abandoned during Second World War. The whole population was transported to Italy as war prisoners. After the end of the war, they returned to Greece and Derveni to find out that their village was completely destroyed. 75 years later, three of the old inhabitants narrated us their story. After this, a short field research took place and the ruins of the Derveni were detected. Now, with our app application, everyone can find the Derveni, listen to the inhabitants talking about its story, and it's no more forgotten. Another example is the historical and cultural characteristics that are shared or not along the cross-border area between Greece and Albania. We recorded legends, traditional songs, and life histories that raise questions of how the national borders are defined, what means to live exactly on the border, how and why the national identities become fluid on the borders. Here you can see the map. Konitsa located is here, and the yellow line is the borders with Albania. All the information included in our interviews is easily accessible to everyone and provides a holistic tourist experience. Every visitor can plan his or her trip in a variety of cross-border settlements and gain information about the local history and culture directly from the inhabitants. Different kinds of groups can create the tours and educational programs in the context of experiential learning, discovering alternative stories about churches, bridges, watermills, forests, mountain peaks, and threshing floors of each settlement. Users will not only consume information stored in the assets of interest, but they will discover the living conditions, the ideas and perception of that period by interacting with people. An interesting thing that I want to point out is the relation of older people with nature. Pre-modern societies perceive the environment not as an external entity, but as a process in which they participated actively and produced meaning through this entanglement with space and time. This meaning was embodied in their culture, for example, the protection of natural environment, or the respect for the nature through sacred forests and trees. For example, we heard a lot of stories about people who cut a tree from a sacred forest and then they were cursed for many, many years. So the main idea is this meaning to be transferred to next generations in order the respect of environment to be embodied in our culture too. To summarize, the content of those oral sources could be used to transform the perception of the environment all around the region and has an inherited additional social value by contributing to the social cohesion, dynamic evolution, and durability of cultural heritage. All these are a way of enhancing the visitor's experience and could move society towards sustainability. Furthermore, through interviews, the local community has its role in the recreation of tourism experiences. Nothing could be possible, have been possible without their contribution. Their willingness to share the stories, their need to say them, made us, it was really moving and gave us strength to really wanted to make more and more interviews with people. To this end, the connection of the touristic information with information acquired from older written sources will result in transforming the library in its physical or digital form into a reference point for all tourists in the area. All this data, which are available to those who may concern, can be combined with other activities such as hiking, rafting, and climbing. The main goal is the development of a more holistic tourism experience under sustainable circumstances. The COVID-19 pandemic and the necessary physical and social isolation made clear the increasing need for more digital contact in the frame of cultural heritage, namely in mountainous and isolated areas where there is a limited number of museums and art galleries, the digital contact seems to be extremely promising. Even if authenticity is partially lost after digitalization, through Exploral, a visitor can experience new cultural landscapes, meet the locals, hear their stories, and engage with their culture. All these result in the development of the tourist product according to the guidelines of sustainable forms of heritage tourism. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Angeliki. That was very interesting to hear about your project. I have one question. You said about the sacred stories of the trees and so on. Could you tell a little more about this and the older people about this connection?
Yes. I don't know if it's in all the Balkans, this perception, but we have some forests, especially around churches. They are named Vakufia, Vakufika. And those forests are always until okay 70s were protected by legends around saints that are protecting those forests. And if anyone went there and cut a tree, would be cursed, and many bad things would happen to him. Of course, this is has a reason. All this story has a reason, because all these forests are in areas around cities that are on the mountains, and if those trees cut, then when it is raining, many soils from the mountain are coming down to villagers and villages. And of course, when people in the previous years were all the time cutting trees and manage the nature more intensively than we would do today, they needed some forests that who would remain unspoiled. Can you understand what, can you follow me? Yes, that's why they protected some places. Yes, and they combined them with legends in order to be protected, those forests.
Yes, you were also talking about the legends and the stories which connects people. As I understood, those legends are shared by those communities on the border. Or could you also tell a little more about this?
Yes, especially traditional songs and music. Because when, okay, the borders with Albania were defined in 1913, yes. And I don't know, I know, but those people who defined the borders, I don't know exactly what they were thinking, but there are some cases that there was a village that belonged after the borders belonged to Albania, but the church of the village belonged to Greece. Okay. And so, yes, before the borders, all this area had common past. Okay. They talked in both language, and they were Muslims and Christians. So there are shared legends about some local heroes of the area we identified that are the same. And after, of course, we have a same legend about the Second World War, or the same history, and the Greek Civil War. Because, okay, the borders were Greece and Albania, but the war was in the same area. And people from the side of Albania were Greeks too. So they had some common legends about heroes of the Second World War and Greek Civil War.
Mm-hmm. Thank you much for the explanation. There is a commented question from Valia Stergioti. Thank you, Angeliki. What would you hope to happen with the results of this project?
Yes, I'm trying to convince everyone in the region that is dealing with that he has touristic offices, and he's For example, he's scheduling hiking or rafting in rivers and activities like that to try to use these results and offer the visit and offer the visitors a more holistic experience, as I mentioned in my presentation. Because, okay, I understand that many people from the cities are stuffed of information about history and museums and all that. But I think when you come to a place that you don't know and you want, okay, you want to go for hiking and be active, but I think if you get some information about the local history and the history of the mountain that you're hiking, I think it's something really interesting. And as many times as I have tried this to include in my hiking some information and share information to other people, they were really interested about this.
So you create memorable experiences for your tourists when you work in the Greek mountains. Mm-hmm. And there is still 3 minutes left. So if some of the participants have a question, we still have some time for it.
Can I I think this presentation goes very, very well with the last workshop that we did from Vasilka, because we share Albania, North Macedonia, Bulgaria, and even if we go to the north, Montenegro, etc., we share so many things in our culture, sometimes, mm-hmm. and nature, obviously. And sometimes we don't even realize them. So such initiatives with oral history and doing some research, local research field studies. It's really, really interesting to rediscover our common identities, because sometimes, you know, politicians focus on the differences we have. So maybe it's on our hand to prove and explore the similarities that we share and then realize who our neighbors are. I'm not sure the rest of Europe understands the situation, because for many, many years, the borders were closed, especially with Albania, but also it was not so easy to travel to Bulgaria or North Macedonia, ex-Yugoslavia, right? So we don't really know each other. It's not like Sweden and Norway. They are really, it's very easy to travel from one side of the border to the other. Not so easy for us. It's only in the last decades, and it's very nice to see young people like Angeliki to take the initiative and do such research and re-explore our neighborhood. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Valia. And I have one quote from your presentation when you were talking about the memories and public memories, that no memories come to us without the context. And I think that's a nice thought, which can end your session. Thank you very much, Angeliki.